Chapter 13. A Way of Life to be Lived. The masters teach us a way of living, a way of approaching our lives, which can turn all our time and all our actions into meditation. If we attend to the meditation practice each day, and then live a true Santmat way of life, we live in the atmosphere of meditation all day. As Maharaj Charan Singh said, if you build that atmosphere of meditation, and you live in that atmosphere, then every breath is meditation. Santmat has been called a school of practical mysticism. It is practical because it is to be practiced, and practical because it relates to every down-to-earth aspect of our daily lives. As Maharaj Charan Singh put it, Santmat is an attitude of mind to be developed and a way of life to be lived. Rather than thinking about truth or discussing and analyzing concepts about truth, we try to live it here and now in the way we conduct our daily lives. The present master was once asked, what is the minimum amount of time we need to spend in meditation each day? He gave a startling answer, 24 hours. Living in obedience and surrender. How do we live a way of life where everything becomes meditation? The life of a disciple, a novice, and learner begins with obedience, plain and simple. Without obedience to our master's instructions, we may as well not have asked for initiation. In the memorable words of Swamiji, implicit obedience to the master of our time is the long and short of everything. The first step in obedience is to obey the simple directive to attend to meditation every day, without regard to whether we feel like it or not, whether we achieve results or not, and whether other demands on our time crop up or not. Obedience means just do it. Just do our meditation. Give our time daily to the meditation practice he has asked us to do. As great master used to ask of his disciples when they met, have you done my work? The implicit obedience Swamiji described, obedience that leaves no room for the intervention of one's own cleverness or objections, is the beginning of a life of surrender. While true surrender is a lofty ideal, and we may think of it as something we will attain at some distant time in the future, this simple act of showing up for meditation practice each day is a big step in the direction of that lofty goal. We can carry the same attitude of implicit obedience into all the activities of our lives, and it will lead to a relaxed, happy, and peaceful life. The masters guide us to make the words of the master the rule of our life. His words and his guidance then form a foundation on which we build a worry-free life. This one action, implicitly following our master's guidance without allowing our own reasoning to object, covers so much. It leads us to forgive where we'd rather hold a grudge, to be kind and compassionate where we'd rather be selfish, to be content where we'd rather grumble and complain. The consequence and enormity of surrender to a saint can make a sinner into a saint. Remaining in obedience can keep us in the carefree bliss of discipleship forever. Just consider how all of the masters have remained disciples throughout their lives. Consider how each master has said his master is in charge of everything. It is he who is doing everything. The master sees himself only as a sevadar, doing the task his master has asked him to do. It has been said that surrender is the most difficult thing in the world when you are doing it, but it is the easiest when it is done. Surrender is a state of an unquestioning mind coupled with implicit trust. However, it is important to remember that surrender is not demanded by a master. Surrender can only be freely given. Living gracefully and cheerfully. How can we live in the Lord's will? From a practical point of view, for all of us who have no ability to discern the will of God, all we can do is to accept and deal cheerfully with whatever situations arise in our lives. We can believe that whatever situations we face, these have been allotted to us because they are for our best and highest good. Highest good may include undergoing pain and pruning. Pain is a part of growth. We are undergoing and clearing our karma. So whatever circumstances we find ourselves in, whatever the challenges, whatever the hardships, or whatever the joys, we can believe they have all come to us according to the Lord's will. We make our best efforts to improve our lot, but we accept however it works out as the Lord's will. As wise elders, whether mystics or not, have always counseled, do your best and leave the rest. Leave the rest for the Lord to work out according to His will. Right action and surrender are two sides of one coin. Doing our best is all we can do, because ultimately there is only His will. May the will of Allah be done, a pious man said. It always is, in any case, said Mullah Nasruddin. How can you prove that, Mullah? Asked the man. Quite simply, if it wasn't always being done by His will, then surely, at some time or another, my will would be done, wouldn't it? As Mullah Nasruddin points out, no matter how much we want this or that to happen, in the end, it is the Lord's will that prevails in life, not ours. The challenge is for us to accept this with good spirit. The present master once summed up a long and complicated question and answer exchange with one simple phrase: His will or nothing. What is the impact of adopting this approach to life? We go through our karmas with equanimity. Rather than resisting, we accept and adjust to the ups and downs as they come. As Maharaj Charan Singh used to put it, we go through our karmas gracefully and cheerfully. Resisting the force of destiny shakes up our equilibrium, whereas acceptance brings equanimity within us. When we try to impose our will on existence, we invite disappointment. Wisdom, what to say of happiness and peace of mind, lies in adhering to the principle of His will or nothing. Going gracefully and cheerfully through our karmas, seeing them as the will of the Lord, gives us a positive attitude. This attitude carries us through the ups and downs of life without forgetting that our highest priority each day is meditation. His will or nothing. As layers of meaning unfold, we discover that here is the core of spiritual life. Keeping a balance. The master so often responds to questions with, keep a balance. The questioner may not even have realized that he or she was going to extremes. Gradually, perhaps over a period of years, as our understanding deepens, we come to see how profound his words are. Taking to heart the master's simple, down-to-earth advice can keep our lives on track. Keep a balance. These three little words, said to us so often by the master of our time, are loaded with meaning and applicable to countless situations in our lives. We get out of balance in so many ways, focusing on our jobs to the detriment of our families, obsessing over our children's lives and forgetting to take care of our own health, or staying up so late watching TV show after TV show that we fail to get up fresh and refreshed for meditation. If we get out of balance, we won't be able to sustain ourselves on our chosen path. So the master says, keep a balance. In these simple words, he compresses a multitude of actions, words, and thoughts, and gives us a deep reservoir of potential wisdom to draw upon. Some may think that, since meditation is the key to the spiritual path, perhaps it would be best to spend as many hours each day in meditation as possible. We may think it best to avoid marriage, leave off developing any profession, not have children, live in solitude meditating all day. But senses that are then suppressed may become more sensitive. Suppressed desires may become stronger. When we go to extremes, our God-given natural system begins to revolt. Therefore, we need to maintain a balance. Therefore, the Master says, live your life in the world. Live the life of a householder. Spirituality can be practiced by an ordinary householder. Masters also have families, yet they keep their balance. A pendulum swings. The farther it swings in one direction, the farther it swings in the other. Even in the midst of the intense activity of a challenging life, with professional and family obligations, we can still the pendulum of our mind, be in the Master's refuge, and remain safe. The secret is in keeping our balance. Taking refuge. For most of us, learning to be a true disciple is a slow process, long and gradual, with whatever transformation it is making in us, often being imperceptible to us. Slow and steady wins the race. It has been said that the path is more long than hard. Maharaj Charan Singh often said that this is the simplest of paths, but it is difficult to follow. To sustain ourselves through the long years of practice, we need help. We need the support and protection of the Master's refuge. Satsang and Seva offer us a place where the atmosphere of the Master's presence uplifts our spirits and bolsters our determination to be steadfast on the path. The Master's refuge keeps us safe from the assaults of a wayward mind. It draws us again and again back to the focus. We get muddled, and it reawakens clarity. Again and again, the Master's refuge brings to our awareness the simplicity of the spiritual path. We remember and recommit to the real purpose of our lives. The Master's refuge is not a structure built with bricks and mortar, nor with wood or plaster or steel. There is only one material used in its construction, and that is love. And there are only two people in the refuge, the Master and the disciple, and his love embraces the whole. Loving him. It is said that when bees are caught out in a storm, they hold fast to little stones to preserve their balance and keep from being blown away. Like the bees, we can hold fast to our love for the Master and preserve our balance through the storms of life. And if our love for the Master seems weak or non-existent to us, we can be held fast by His love for us, which, as we go forward on this path, we will find is as wide as the whole world. His love for us is love for the Lord, for the All, for the One. He embraces all in His love, and in His eyes, we too are part of that One, each of us. We live through countless fleeting relationships, seeking, finding, and losing. If we do not know it yet, then life teaches us that to expect perfect love in human relationships is a folly. Human life is perishable and short-lived. The love that holds us together, the one that is permanent, the one that encompasses our entire being, is the love between Master and disciple. Because at its depth, it is the love between the Lord and the soul. our capacity to love is limited. The love the saints lead us to is not a matter of fluctuating emotions. The affection and gratitude we feel may be only a dim reflection of the real love, the love that dissolves all separations and leads to union. How do we grow in this love? The Master has given a simple answer. He says, love means to give, give, and give. Give in totality, give completely, and give entirely. No barriers. We are to just give wholeheartedly. Give to a point of removing the self. No expectations, just giving. That is discipleship. So we begin by giving the only gift we have to give, our time and attention. 2.5 hours of our time, accompanied by whatever amount of our attention we are able to gather and give. It is a small gift. It may seem to us a paltry gift when we consider the scattered attention we bring to the meditation practice. But nonetheless, it is a gift of love.